Hey everybody, this is Robbie coming to you from Salty Church, and you're going to want to pay attention to this one. The topic is sex. Yeah, that's right. We're doing a series called Pull Up a Chair, and we've asked for input from you about hot topics, typical things that you think the church needs to be talking about, and there's no wonder that a big topic was of a sexual nature. And so this past weekend, I talked about that, tried to dive into it to a certain extent, answering the question, what is sexual purity and why does it matter? So that was the message from this past weekend. If you missed it, go back to salty.org. You can find it. But what I wanted to do in this video is to follow in with even a more narrow aspect of that, trying to hit some key principles, referencing really within that topic of sexual purity, within the idea of heterosexual marriage, what is holy and what's not? How should we be thinking about that? And let me tell you, this is a difficult subject. There is nothing easy about this at all because there's so many misconceptions and ideas and cultural inputs and all of that, that it really is hard. So I'm going to try to hit some of these things and hit some of these in a way that's going to relate to many different aspects of it. But, you know, when you think about sex within marriage, even like what is the point of sex and those kinds of things, there's a lot of stereotypes. Even and especially within the Christian culture, that sex is for procreation, and you know, it maybe that's all. Some people hold on to that, or yeah, it's fun, but sometimes it's obligation. Many women are taught that sex is for the man, so he won't cheat on you. You know, stay faithful. It's for something for women to endure. You know, men need sexual release regularly and frequently, and so you got to deal with all that. So these stereotypes, along the line of also frequency. When you talk about libido, oftentimes the stereotype is it's about the men and what the men need and when they meet and frequency and all that. When research says that over 20% of the marriages have women who have the stronger libido. So there is a lot of ideas out there, what's true, what's not. And there's so much to talk about. Let me just hit a couple principles that might help from a biblical standpoint to help us to find and to navigate truth. So one of the things I'm going to do is I'm going to talk to you a minute about 1 Corinthians 7, and that all by itself is not easy. 1 Corinthians 7 is Paul writing a letter to a church in Corinth doing the exact same thing I'm doing. Difficult topic. How do we think about this? Paul gives his perspective, and it's a part of our scriptures. And what's interesting about this too is Paul, as he's writing, writes it in Greek, or it's translated into Greek, and then we translate it into English. And it's interesting how different English translators will translate this one chapter. I want to encourage you, find an app, read 1 Corinthians 7 in more than one translation. So for instance, NIV, he starts out right at the top of the chapter. He says, it's good for a man not to have sexual relations with a woman. And if you read that first sentence all by itself, you're like, what does that mean? Like, why does he say it that way? And the Passion Translation more translates it a little bit differently. He's like, you know, for my response to you concerning these questions, is it proper for a man to live in celibacy? Or it is proper for a man to be celibate, but let me give you some more. Because there's immorality in the world, Paul goes on and says, each husband, and each translation of these next few verses varies a little bit. That's why looking at multiples will help you. But because there's sexual immorality in the world, Paul says, each man should have sexual relations with his own wife and each woman with her own husband. And then we get into a lot of trouble because the stereotypes hit hard when people read one or two verses and don't read the whole thing. The husband should fulfill his marital duty to his wife, and likewise the wife to her husband. The wife does not have authority of her own body, but yields it to her husband. And if we put a period there and we stop and we don't go on and keep reading, there are some who would use Bible to manipulate in order to get what they want. Well, you belong to me and you can't say no. That's what Paul said in the Bible in 1 Corinthians 7. Well, yeah. He did say that, but let's talk about the whole thing and let's give it context. And I think that's why it's really important. Again, the Bible's full of content related to sex in a variety of different ways, especially in marriage. So make sure when you're reading the Bible, you're using other parts of the Bible to interpret that which you're reading, and never, ever use the Bible as a weapon to get what you want on any topic, because then that becomes a problem in sin. And so look at the whole thing. I mean, Paul, as he's writing, he says we have responsibility, a husband to his wife and a wife to the husband. And he does talk about like having ownership and authority of your own body. The wife does not have authority over her own body, but yields it to her husband. And in the same way, the husband does not have authority over his own body, but yields to his wife. And that yielding is both in a positive and in a negative. When you want something, you may not be able to get it. And sometimes when the other person wants it, you need to be able to comply. And so that's where oftentimes this gets to be tension in here. You know, Paul goes on and gives advice, is, you know, don't deprive each other except for by mutual consent. And that mutual consent and equality in Scripture, I think, is really important. So read through. That's just a little hint of 1 Corinthians 7. There's a whole lot there. Dig into that. But then apply other Scriptures to the way that you interpret it. So, for instance, Ephesians 5 talks a lot about marriage. And one of the first verses there is Ephesians 5:21, submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. To submit to one another. That's both submitting. And so I think it's really important, and I especially like that word submission. It's underneath the mission. It's to both agree on the directive of your mission together and operate that way. So what is your mission? I mean, overall, it ought to be unity. So the things that you decide together. So if we're talking about sex and frequency and all the other variations of things, what are you deciding on together under the mission? What is the mission? Paul goes on in In Ephesians 5, he says, wives, submit to your husbands. Again, that's not all he says, but he says that. He also goes on to say, husbands ought to love their wives as their own body. He who loves his wife loves himself. There's this idea of equality and working together in unity. The two shall become one. And so as you think about sexuality in marriage, I think it's important to understand that unity ought to guide the way and lead the way. And if there's a problem in there, let's get some help and to figure out what the problem is and solve it. Not just getting what you need when you need it, whether it's stereotypical men from women, but or the other way around. Let's be talking through this. So I think what's important as a principle about what's okay or not okay within the context of marriage, you know, if this is a one-sided conversation where one person has to submit to the other without mutual respect and fulfillment, there's a problem. So let that guide your way. One of the other little subparts of this, I think it's really important, answering a question, what's out of bounds, what's holy or not within marriage. Again, a key principle from the very beginning, Genesis 2, what God has joined together, let no one separate. So don't let anything come between you. Men, don't bring in things into your marriage that are going to come between you. Women, don't bring things into your marriage that are going to divide you and, or come in between you. That's not good. Mutual fulfillment, mutual love, mutual sex, mutual respect, healing, all of that. There's so much pain that comes in this conversation, whether it's marriage or outside of marriage. And there's so much pain because it's been understood so badly and applied so badly, whether it's from abuse or ignorance or what. We got to recognize that we all come to the table with a certain level of pain. We got to be careful and then also protect against future pain. People ask about like pornography, for instance. And I always say outside sex inside your marriage is going to be a problem. Don't bring anything into your marriage. It's going to create division. It has to be unity and to protect the gift that God has given. I think it's really important, and not at all for a second is this easy. So we've got certain resources that we want to give to help along the way. This is just this is almost a sound bite of help. I want to send you to places to really work through this. And if we can be of help, we want to do that. You have websites like Fight the New Drug that talks about the power of pornography and why it's a problem. So Google search Fight the New Drug. It's really critical. But also I found a new resource, a blog and a book. And the blog has got a really cool title, to love, honor, and vacuum.com. Really cool. She's got a million things in there that can really be helpful, but also her book. I have no idea who she is. And I'm not pitching the book because of her, but because the material there is revolutionary to me, teaching me some new things that I hadn't really considered, giving perspective to men from a women's viewpoint and vice versa. The Great Sex Rescue really helpful. We'll have links that we can post in there so you can find that. I know this is very difficult, and there is pain that comes with it, but it doesn't have to be that way. There is hope, there is healing, and there is amazing, amazing fulfillment and joy in this as well. Go find it. If we can help you, we want to help you. Leave us comments. Send me an email if you got more questions, robbie@salty.org. Fill out a connection card, whatever you need. We want to help point you into the direction of healing and hope for the best possible future. So that's a lot. Send some questions if you want. I want to dig in and help you. We're here. So that said, have a great week. Look forward to seeing you again at Salty Church. Thanks.